Welcome to the Genealogy Gems podcast, providing quick and innovative ways to make the absolute most out of your research time and creative ideas for sharing and displaying your family history. I'm your host, Lisa Louise Cook. Welcome to episode 30 of the Genealogy Gems podcast. I'm really excited today because I have a very special interview to share with you. But before we get to that, we've got a few other items to cover. It's been so fun to put together the new listener page on the website, which of course you will find at genealogygems.tv. Alan and Steve, Richard and Michael, they have all sent in photos and even videos of themselves or a representation thereof. But do you notice a trend here? Only men have sent in photos. Come on, ladies, you need to be represented. I know that you're out there. So this week, I want to see some of the ladies in the audience. Send a photo of yourself listening to the podcast on your iPod or computer, or holding up something that you found since listening to the podcast, or both, as Richard Horaznik did. In his photo, he's listening to his iPod and holding up his Freedom of Information Act immigration request that we talked about in episode 21. So ladies, don't make me beg. Get to busy and email a photo for the listener page today to genealogygemspodcast@gmail.com. And speaking of the website, I completely confess that web design is not my area of expertise. I can hack my way around enough to get things I want to share with you up on the website, but the left side of my brain is usually getting a cramp. I realized a few weeks ago as I was adding more and more content to the website that it was getting tougher and tougher to find what you want quickly. So I became determined to add a search box to the homepage. Well, this week I got it up and running. So now when you go to genealogygems.tv, you will find the search box on the left side of the homepage under the navigation menu. So I hope that you will use it and that you will find it helpful in getting to where you want to go. Okay, now we're done taking care of our to-do list. So sit back and enjoy this week's gem. In episode 29, I told you about a wonderful movie that I saw recently called Sweetland. It's a film about Norwegian immigrants in rural Minnesota following World War I. I feel so passionate about it, not only because it's about family history, but because it's such a rare thing to find a gem like this that you can watch with your entire family. There just aren't enough of these movies being made. I figured that anyone who could make a movie like this must be pretty special, and I think that after you listen to this interview, you will realize just how special Ali Selim, the director of Sweetland, really is. I had a chance to talk to Ali this week, and we chatted about his immigrant parents, the power of memories, and some of the terrific actors that he features in the film. And after the interview, I will tell you about a very special video cast available this week as well. But for now, my conversation with Ali Selim. You know, every once in a while, a movie really just seems to reach out and grab hold of you. And for me, Sweetland is really one of those movies. I'm really pleased today to be joined by Ali Selim, director of this very thoughtful and lovely movie about family and memories. Hi, Ali.
Hi, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for taking some time out to talk to
Thanks
us.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate the fact that people appreciate the movie, and if they appreciate it, I then love talking about it. So.
Wonderful. Well, then you will have a captive audience in this interview because I loved the movie. And, you know, I was thinking a lot last night about why I identified so much with that movie. You know, there are the obvious associations with oral family history. And as you know, I'm a genealogist. That's who my audience is. And, you know, but thinking back over it, there was a scene really early in the movie where Inga is older and she's mourning the death of her husband, Olaf. And I remember she was sitting in her living room and her grandson is sitting near her. And her son, who is older, obviously, is standing over them, kind of sounding a bit scolding and being very practical about what should be done with the body. And there's all this tension. And in the middle of it, there's this really quiet understanding between the grandson and the grandmother. And there's something about the distance of a generation, I think, that brings empathy and compassion back into relationships. You know, that can be sometimes hard for a parent and a child to reach in the later years. And
yeah, I think that's a really good observation on your part, but I don't think it's maybe as intellectually complex. I think it just boils down to the fact that the grandparents are not responsible for the discipline, and they can you know, feed candy to the grandkids, and it connects them on a different level than the disciplinarian relationship of a parent. I've witnessed it with my dad. I mean, my dad and I have a very good relationship, and I feel like my son and I have a very good relationship, but my son's relationship with my dad is so much more, I don't know, loving or deeper or interesting, and I really think it boils down to the fact that Grandpa brought him candy when he was a kid, and I said no.
Right. So, he didn't have to mess with all that authority stuff. He could just know him as a person.
Exactly. And I certainly don't mean to make light of your comment, because I do think that those sort of generational things are really interesting. But I just, I think that's kind of where it comes from.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I know that this was a real labor of love for you, and one that took, what, about 15 years to complete, right?
Yeah. I mean, you know, the picture that's painted when people say that is that I was kind of a lonely guy sitting in a barren attic trying to get this thing off the ground. But I was directing TV commercials at the time. I had a very good career in advertising, and I directed 850 TV commercials. I worked nonstop. I raised three beautiful kids with my wife and coached probably 1,000 Little League games. So there was a lot going on in my life as I was trying to figure out. I think, number one, the first hurdle was that this was not an overtly commercial film. But it took me 5 years to realize that Hollywood wasn't going to finance this film to the tune of $50 million. You know, it was just a quiet little film. And so then I had to readjust after 5 years and think, okay, how am I going to get this film done? And it's tricky. You know, it took me 5 years then to figure that out. Like, how can you do it for almost nothing? And how can you attract actors that will allow you to sell it? And how do you write a script that attracts them? And so there was a lot going on in those 16 years other than just some poor schmuck wishing that he could make a film.
I take it it's quite a bit of a different world than the more commercial world in terms of trying to put together a film that means so much to you, but that may not have the huge commercial pull.
Yeah, you know, unfortunately, it all boils down to economics. It's just a matter of how much do you think this film will make when it's done, and if you really think it will make that, then you'll have to make it for somewhat less than that. Mm-hmm. And we just didn't know, you know, because in the end, as great as the response has been, and, you know, this film opened in theaters a year ago, and here I am talking to you, still talking about the film. So there's been a really interesting response from probably a larger audience than a lot of people expected, but we just didn't know, you know, going into it. It's like, I knew from my commercial career that it would be in color and it would be in focus, but beyond that, we just didn't know. So we didn't have a sense of what world we were playing in other than this crazy world of, I have to make this. You know, I have to make this film. I have so much emotional debt that I've created over the 15 years that if I don't make it, I don't know what's going to happen to me. So that was kind of our driving force.
Right. Well, tell us a little bit about the original story that you drew from and, you know, what kept you focused with all of the other things pulling at you with daily life? What kept you mesmerized with this project and seeing it to completion?
Yeah, I think when I first read the story, it was in the Minneapolis Star and Tribune Sunday supplement, like a magazine section. And I was drawn to it, and I read it, and when I got to the end, I was really taken by surprise that I cried, because I majored in English Lit, and I read volumes and volumes and volumes, and I had become sort of desensitized to that process, or maybe intellectualized. You know, it was like, this is a good writer and this is a bad writer, and that's about it. And I got to the end of this tiny little short story that's so sparsely written, and I cried, and that really fueled me to go and get the rights, figuring if I cried, other people would cry. And then part of what fueled me really is just that initial reaction. I just knew that other people would feel, not necessarily cry, but, you know, feel when they saw this movie, which I think is so much more important than think after you see a movie. And secondly is sort of what I referenced earlier. I once had the pleasure of meeting John Sayles, the great independent director. Mm-hmm. And he said the trick to making these films is you have to get yourself so deeply in debt that you can't afford not to make the movie. And, you know, he's speaking financially, but he's also speaking emotionally and spiritually. And I think I was at the point where it was in me and it had to come out.
Absolutely. Well, I really believe that this film is going to strike a chord with those of us who are really passionate about exploring family history. And I think I read something about that you or the other producers of the film were, many of you were first-generation Americans. Is that right?
Well, my father is an Egyptian immigrant. He came over in the 50s. My mother's parents came over from Germany. And I think that's it. The other couple of producers were longtime American mutts. And Alan Cumming is Scottish, so it doesn't even really apply. He is an immigrant himself. Now he lives in New York. A lot of this film came from observing my father's experience, even though I wasn't born when he came and I was very young, you know, as he was assimilating into the culture. But I still think a lot of it was just observing what he was going through and listening to my grandparents' stories about having come over.
So was that was oral history something that happened in your family? Did you get to spend very much time hearing those stories?
I forced the issue.
Really?
I don't know why I'm so fascinated by it, but I have been. You know, I've always been enamored with storytellers and specifically historical storytellers, because I find historical storytellers are more interested in, maybe it's the emotion, again, which is what I connect to, as opposed to the history books, which are interested in dates and facts and figures, which doesn't really do much for me. Mm-hmm. At one point years ago when I was exploring what film I might want to make, I met Hilda Neihardt, whose father is John Neihardt, who wrote Black Elk Speaks. Mm-hmm. And Hilda went with John the summer that he interviewed Black Elk, and sitting at the table, at the dinner table, she had me to her house for dinner, and sitting there realizing that I was, you know, however you want to call it, really just one degree of separation from Black Elk, was really, it really rocked my world. And I thought, this is the way to keep this kind of stuff alive, is to, you know, touch people and reach beyond and tell these stories. And I know that my film isn't the same thing because it's not first person.
Right.
Oral history, but it's that kind of thing that interests me. If people tell, you know, and that's a big part of what's in the film is, you know, Lars telling his daughter. I mean, it's all poetically suggested, but at the end, we assume that Lars is going to show her the photograph that his grandmother showed him that Franzen took, and just keeps this whole thing connected and alive.
Mm-hmm. You know, I was watching the making of Sweetland. It's the clip that appears on the website, and I think there's maybe even a longer version on the DVD. And you made a similar statement that really hit me. You said that you approached the telling of this story from the standpoint of memory versus one of facts and figures. As you mentioned, it's a story that Lars remembers his grandmother Inga telling him. And I really admired that you didn't try to claim that you knew exactly how it would be back then, as oftentimes historians and even genealogists can get kind of caught up in trying to do, but rather you took that position that we as people today, what we have is shared memories. And, you know, the oral tradition is, you know, as old as time. And what techniques did you use to communicate that this was the first and foremost a memory in the movie? I mean, you didn't try to make it literal, although I love the fact that it was in color.
Well, to me, that's, you know, a lot of people suggested that it be shot in sepia or black and white, and I thought, why? I mean, even if I were making a period piece, which I don't believe I did, because I feel like the film takes place in Lars' head. This is Lars' picture of Inga's painting.
Yes.
This the story. And, you know, to shoot it in black and white and suggest this is the past makes no sense to me, because Inga's memories of that time are perhaps more real and more colorful than her present life.
Yes.
And they're more, I believe, that your memory is a little less cluttered. It's, you know, you remember the whiteness of the house and the greenness of the grass, and that memory is so strong that you maybe don't remember all the chickens running around the yard making a bunch of noise, you know? And so you just pare it down to those things. And whether or not that hits home with the audience, those are the kind of things we did. It's like, what would Inga remember? And if she remembered a detail or two details, those to me were more important than, all right, let's make the yard look like it did, or let's make the house look a little windblown, or, because I don't think she would remember that.
Right.
And I sort of don't think that she would have even seen it that way, you know? And so there are little games like that, the colors, the way they dressed, just the fact that, you know, this device of Lars thinking back to the time when he was told the story and then carrying it on to his daughter at the end, I think is, they're all just quiet little devices that say, this is an oral history and not a filmmaker's period piece.
Exactly. It always kills me when I watch a period piece and they show everything, but everything looks like an antique, which of course back then would have been oftentimes something new.
Exactly.
And I love the scene where they, Franzen and Olaf are trying to take photographs and they're out in front of the house. And you've used, I thought it was a really neat technique as a director to film it through the perspective of what does it look like through the camera lens? And it struck me because I am very fortunate. I have a lot of old photographs from my family that go pretty far back. And you look at these black and white old tattered things and you try to imagine. But on your film, you made it come alive that actually you could almost imagine the old photograph that you'd see today, but what it must have looked like for Olaf through the camera. It really reminded us that, you know, old pictures were not always old. Those happenings were very modern at the time.
Yeah, and I mean very modern because, you know, Franzen was the only guy around to have a camera, so the whole thing was very new and exciting, and, you know, as confounding to them as this microphone was to me today, you know? So yeah, I think it was a totally new thing. And another thing that, in terms of the memory, I have to say it now even though you didn't ask the question, is my grandmother, my German grandmother, who was from a farm in southern Minnesota, had a large box of photographs, just throwing them all in there. And some of them were like that. Some of them were, you know, 1920, very first camera in town. At one point we said, you know, Grandma, you got to go through and label these so we know who, what, when, where, why. And so she spent a lot of time doing it. And then we went through the box later to put them in photo albums. And she'd written on the back, "Me and him taken 8 years ago." So we still have no record, but I think that's an interesting record in and of itself.
I think it's so sweet. I have those photographs, and you turn them over, and you think, I could just hear my great-grandmother. Well, I know who that is.
Yeah.
You know, why would I put his name on
exactly.
there?
Exactly. Exactly.
That's a wonderful story. Now, you mentioned Alan Cummings. If folks maybe do or don't recognize the name, but he was in Circle of Friends and Pride and Prejudice. Certainly one of my favorites, and he just became Franzen. I mean, he just jumped off the screen, and I always marvel that he can do just about any accent that is out there.
He's fabulous.
Tell us how he came to the film, and he ended up helping you produce. Is that right?
Yeah. First of all, let me say I'm glad that you felt that way about him. I think it could have gone either way, and you know, enough people have said I didn't get why you cast him. I would have cast, you know, Stellan Skarsgård or somebody a little more obvious in that role. And I just felt like, I mean, in a little bit, he's based on my grandfather who was, you know, not a large Scandinavian man, but, kind of slight and, mm-hmm. and very funny and very influenced by vaudeville as opposed to his heritage, and listened to music and quoted the music, and I just thought, you know, that's how people really were. You could have made this movie with predictable, large, potato-handed Scandinavian farmers, but I just don't think everybody was like that, and I think that's what gives the story texture. And Alan, you know, when I first read the short story, I knew that Olaf needed... Franzen's not in the short story. And I knew that Olaf wasn't completely alone, and I knew that he needed somebody to talk to communicate some of these things that in the short story were internal.
Oh, absolutely.
And I also knew that I needed a visual contrast to Olaf, a visual, you know, Franzen spends money, Olaf doesn't. Franzen has all the stuff, Olaf doesn't. And the more you can show that, unless you can talk about it, the better. So I knew I wanted a character there. And around the time that I started writing, I met Alan through a mutual friend, and he entertained us at dinner with accents and stories. And I just thought, this is the guy. I mean, almost not like this guy could play my grandfather, but this guy is my grandfather. Right. And we became friends, you know, back in the middle 90s, I think, and he loved the script. I think part of it was he recognized himself in it because I'd written it for him. And part of it was maybe that he had spent a lot of time doing the makeup jobs like X-Men 2 and Spy Kids and things like that, and I think he saw something just simple and organic and actorly for him. And so he took the role before I even had a project, just an early script, like probably back in 98. And then stayed with it and would call and ask how the fundraising was going. And at one point I said, just not at all. And he said, well, if I produced, would that help? And I assumed it would. So he signed on probably in 2000 as a producer. And I think what he brought to it, especially after he finished Anniversary Party, which he put together with an amazing cast, I think he brought sort of a pedigree that said, not only will this commercial director make the film in color and in focus, but Alan will make sure that it's good. Mm-hmm. So it really helped and sort of took the whole budget, but more importantly, the whole casting thing across the finish line.
Oh, I bet. I mean, I'm sure that good talent draws good talent.
Yeah, and I'm sure they all trusted me, but, you know, didn't know for sure. And Alan, they knew for sure. And Ned Beatty wanted to make a movie with Alan, and John Hurd wanted to make a movie with Ned Beatty, and Alex Kingston and Alan go way back to London, and... You know, so everybody was, it was like a family moving out there.
Oh, I bet.
Rural Minnesota.
People who had the guts to leave their town, their village, their parish, get to the seaside they had never seen before, get on a boat that could have taken weeks or months to get there, these had to be some pretty tough cookies. I mean, some people who really had some guts, who had some vision. And I think Franzen really, to me, communicated you had to be a bit of a dreamer. You know, you had to be able to visualize. And I love the way that you used the slides they were watching. And he brought that life and vision to a community that culturally isn't really known for all that daydreaming.
Yeah.
And, him and his bigger, better, faster. Bigger, better, faster. I mean, he got the concept. He wasn't necessarily great at the work, you know. Brownie was good at that. But I love that he's not stereotypical, because I just don't think that people who got on boats and did things and took risks, particularly when folks left behind in the old world, were saying, you are crazy.
Well, I think people came for a million different reasons, you know, and they were driven by a million different things. I think Olaf may have been driven by the practicality of it. I think that he maybe couldn't get his hands on a piece of decent land in Norway, and he thought, well, it's more practical to go there. It wasn't even a dream. But
exactly.
I think Inga came with a dream and a desire to make the dream work, and Franzen came with desire in his heart. And, you know, I think it's all a little different. I think sometimes we are a little too locked into, you know, the stoic practical view, and it's not the way it was.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to sort of explore that side of how would these people have really been.
No, I loved Franzen's character because of that. And I just thought he brought a lot of truth and, of course, the levity. And he was terrific. And again, of course, I'm coming to you as probably a very non-traditional interview. And then I'm coming from that genealogist perspective. But another scene that stuck out to me was with Brownie sitting at the dinner table. And she's emphatically saying, I'm an American.
Yeah.
You know, and she goes on to explain, you know, yes, her parents are European, but I am an American. And I just love that. I thought that that type of spirit was really definitely conveyed by, you know, my great-grandparents. They came to America to become Americans, not German-Americans, you know.
Exactly.
They hung on to their culture. They had, you know, he ate his pickles and his raw oysters and, you know, that kind of thing, my great-grandfather, but he was an American. And I was wondering, did that scene come from the original story, or was that something that you kind of pulled out of your hat and fit into the what you were trying to say?
Well, it's a direct quote from my mother. over and over. And it always surprised me because she's so German.
Yes.
And almost denied it.
Yeah.
You know? And I just was always fascinated by that because I feel, you know, the blood pulsing through my veins feels very Egyptian and very German.
Mm-hmm.
And I can tell you when I react to something, what nationality is reacting to it. I mean, it's that clear to me. And I, you know, when people say, where's your passport? I say, I have an American passport, but I never feel like I am an American. And it just always struck me when my mom would say that, and her brother too, and sometimes her mother.
Yes.
So, no, that was not in the original story, because Franzen and Brownie are not in the original story.
Oh, exactly. Okay.
So.
Well, I thought that was tremendous, and like you say, it was very typical. It's not that they weren't living their culture. They just knew who they were now, you know.
Yeah.
And in some ways, it kind of reflected how hard it was for Inga to get her papers, so those with papers had something to brag about, you know.
Yeah.
And they were all legit. Well, it's a tremendous movie. As I say, I'm definitely looking at it from the family historian perspective. And my hope is that the listeners listening to this interview, listening to obviously your passion for the story, for family history, that, it, you know, one of the things we all suffer from as genealogists is oftentimes we're passionate and our relatives are saying, huh, you know, why does this matter? And I think a movie like Sweetland is something that you could sit down together as a family and watch, and the non-historians in the family could say, wow, you know, did our great-grandmother ever tell you stories? Or did, you know, where exactly do we come from? It just seems like it would open up so many possibilities for good conversation.
I think it already has, and I hope it continues to. My favorite movies are the ones that you can go to with your father and your son, or your mother and your daughter, and I hope that I've made one, and I hope that it inspires families to gather around and talk.
I think you have, and I really applaud you for that. Having three daughters of my own, it's getting more challenging these days to even find a movie that you can all go to together. And this one was not only, you know, terrific and very romantic. This was a very romantic movie, and nobody took their clothes off.
Yeah. I had one. I screened it once in a rough cut form for a screenwriting class just to get some feedback, and I was surprised how much they really liked it and connected to it and had valuable input. But there was one woman, a very hip-hop, sort of beautiful hip-hop rhythm in the front row, and she raised her hand at the end and she said, you know, I kept waiting for the throwdown and it never came. And then I thought, damn, this is the sexiest movie I've ever seen.
Exactly.
And, you know, then, like, for little kids, you can take little kids, and I think it's lost on them in a way. You know,
mm-hmm.
they miss some of that, the heat that's generated by the staring. So,
but that's why we can all enjoy it in the same room, but for very different reasons.
Exactly.
Well, before I let you go, tell our audience what you're working on now. What's on the horizon for you?
I've just finished an adaptation of a novel by Pete Houtman, a young adult novel called Godless.
Mm.
And it's about four teenage boys who, during their summer of rebellion, reject their parents' Catholicism and form their own religion, worshiping the town water tower, and in the process realize how dangerous it is to be an adult and what responsibility comes with freedom. And it's really amusing on, you know, having the ability to question and the power of, you know, defining yourself through questioning the world around you. And it's going to be produced by Albert Brooks and Ron Yerxa, who produced Little Miss Sunshine last year.
Oh, wonderful.
So I'm excited about that because it means that my wife and I don't have to do it out of our dining room like we did Sweetland.
Right.
And then there's some other things, you know, scripts I'm reading and other books I'm reading, but I think that's going to be next.
And are you continuing with your commercial work as well?
I haven't had time, actually. I've either been working on Sweetland, traveling, promoting Sweetland, or writing the next thing. So I guess I'd like to get back into it because it was nice to have income, which I don't right now.
Mm-hmm.
But I also like being an independent filmmaker, and I think if you're going to be an independent filmmaker, you don't have income.
Right.
You just have to figure it out some other way.
Sounds like being a podcaster.
Probably.
Yeah. Well, Ali, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us today. And we're going to keep an eye on what you're doing because I just think Sweetland is tremendous. And thanks again for talking with us.
I really appreciate it. Thank you.
You bet. So much fun getting to talk to Ali Selim, and don't you just love that music in the background? Well, that music actually comes from the soundtrack of the movie Sweetland, and as I say, it just sets a wonderful tone for the entire film. Now, before the interview, I mentioned to you that I have a very special video cast for you this week. I believe most of you are probably subscribing through iTunes, and that is probably the easiest way to get the video cast. The file can be found under the Genealogy Gems podcast, and it's called Videocast Sweetland. The videocast runs about 10 minutes, and it's portions of our interview put together with lots of photographs from the movie and just things that we're talking about. And it's something that you can download and actually put right onto your video iPod if you have one, or you can watch it from your computer. So I hope you will enjoy that. That is the second video cast for Genealogy Gems, and they are a joy to make, and it is fun to be able to bring to your eyes some of which we're bringing to your ears. So enjoy. By the way, Sweetland is available on DVD, and I will have a link for you in the episode 30 show notes, as well as a link to that beautiful music that you heard. That's the Sweetland soundtrack, and that is also available on CD, so I'll have that for you as well. And one last note, wanted to mention to you to keep an eye out in the video cast when Ali Selim talks about his grandparents. The photograph that you see there are his grandparents, and that's William and Sophie Niemeier. Well, thank you so much for joining me for this week's episode of the Genealogy Gems podcast. As always, you can contact me at genealogygemspodcast@gmail.com. And of course, I invite you to visit the website. Do it often because there's lots of new stuff coming down the pike, and you can find it at genealogygems.tv. So until next time, have a wonderful week, friend, and I will talk to you soon.